based on the study on deep state insecurity on both sides, not just in the United States, but in China. But if I have to use one word to describe the bilateral relationship between the United States and China, that word would be uncertainty. That what worries me most, because I don't care if China and the United States want to be enemy against each other, if they can be consistent. That was not worries me, because if I can predict your behavior tomorrow, day after tomorrow, or day after tomorrow, I know how to deal with it. The problem is that we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, because uncertainty caused by three levels or three areas. The first of all, of course, is the leadership style or personality. We know that Donald Trump is a game changer in Reagan. He has tried to destroy everything we hold as normal in this town, Washington, D.C. And his, this kind of anti-established behavior is not just childish, but it's uncertain. We don't know. It's, every morning you don't know what's going to happen, what's going to do on his trips. So he's a game breaker. In Chinese, we call it poor juju. But on the same, for the same reason, President Xi Jinping is also a game changer. He has, under his leadership, thousands, hundreds of thousands of senior cadres and officers being indicted for corruption, which is right, I think that's right and good. He also tried to launch unprecedented reform in China called the reform supply side, aimed at restructure Chinese economy to make it more sustainable, but of course, that caused a lot of struggles because anti-corruption essentially is an anti-monopoly of privileged interest groups in terms of economic development. Internationally, he also brought about One Belt, One Road initiative, which is very ambitious, and also tried to establish a so-called community with shared destiny, and also take offensive almost in all front as China, in his work, is entering the central stage of global affairs. Of course, especially some high-profile propaganda-driven talks from Beijing, in my view, does not do China any good. So all of this has deepened the kind of frustration in the United States, anxiety, that is, despite over 30 years of engagement, China has not and will not develop in the direction desired by the policymakers of engagement. China will not ever become, like us, a kind of Anglo-Saxon style democracy. Instead, China is going to go its own way, insist on its own political system. For China, I think it's good, but for people in this side, it's almost nightmarish. As a result, in my view, it has become a consensus in US political establishment that China is undermining fundamentally and substantially the US interests, both internally and externally. So it's time to do something and stop this kind of development. That's a consensus, but the differences are how to do it. And fortunately or unfortunately, we have a president called Donald Trump who knows what he does not want, but I doubt he knows what he really wants. That's a problem. That's the first level of our leadership style. And second level, I think that the United States has been tough on China, it's not just trying to contain or balance China, as Michael said, but also it's the only way to handle the problem at home. We have many problems here in the United States. Politically, it's almost irreconcilably divided. Economically, it's highly polarized. And strategically, the resources has been misplaced internally and externally. We know that after Soviet Union collapse, in a kind of jubilance, Clinton administration has started the so-called globalism strategy, which has three dimensions. The first is try to globalize American value system, called the universal values. that does not work very well. Has strong resistance both from Islamic culture and also, of course, from China. The second dimension is the globalization of political democracy, which in my view has failed miserably. You have two waves of so-called democratization movement in the world. First is so-called color revolution, except a few small countries in Eastern Europe who has come from Christianity civilization, but being absorbed quickly by Europe. The others, all the back, who also retired Russia, Romania, the Balkans, Ukraine, and of course, Russia. And after that, we have Arab Spring, which miserable. None of the countries went through Arab Spring succeeded. We end up in a very more chaotic, politically and economically, and socially totally fragmented, caused huge problems. But the only dimension that has been successful is the globalization of economy, economic globalization. But instead of benefit from it, the United States has probably suffered from it because it caused three things. Number one is that we have a globalized capitalism, but politics remains local. But the entire political process is financed by globalized capitalism, but you have certain voters who cannot go abroad and stay. That kind of, you know, division has caused huge problem. And secondly, that when Fukuyama wrote this article called The End of History, we truly believe that it's a perfect marriage, the market economy and liberal democracy. But turned out, after 30 years of economic globalization, market economy and democracy do not have to have this kind of fidelity. Market economy driven by profits, and democracy has more of human rights. So as a result, we have two forces going against each other. On the one hand, we have globalization of capitalism, in which drives capital, the amount of cash, from rich country to poor country, for what? Maximize profits. But on the other hand, we have another force drive, it's called economic globalization, is what I call internationalization of manufacturing and services. This force, this flow drives products, merchandise, service from poor country to rich country, but the two goes against each other. So therefore, we have a phenomenon, unprecedented, what I call the rich have debt, the poor have money. You know, usually the rich have money, the poor have debt, but not all the developed countries are in deep debt except Germany. But developing countries like China, India, has piles of cash, but the decision making international is still come to buy those who do that. Now those who have credits. That's another problem here. And last but not the least of the problem, the information relationship has deprived the kind of privilege the decision makers or elites used to have. They always get information ahead of time, so have time to digest, analyze all the information to make tough choice or rational choices. And now information revolution enabled all of us got information simultaneously. So decision makers do not really have time to digest this information, but to make the first response as quickly as possible if they want to hold the power. But we know that the first response we have against whatever happened is come from your heart, not from your brain. Because what makes you think, what makes you respond is something that either makes you happy or makes you mad. When you are happy or mad, your response, your decision is emotional, not rational. That's where my populists like Donald Trump and some Europe get more and more in power because they are the one who knows how to tweak their first response to society, but not really good for the world. In all those regards, the United States blamed China because China fully benefited from globalization of capitalism, and China has become one of the largest exports of all the manufacturers, and China still has information control, which for good or for bad, enables leaders to make more rational choices in decision making rather than ad hoc. So therefore, I believe being tough on China is not just trying to balance China's development, but also it's necessary for people here, for us to handle our problems there. And this has happened actually twice. Once is after McCarthyism. The late 50s, 1960s, Kennedy and Johnson has used a very strong and assertive Soviet Union to accomplish a lot of necessary reform at home, like Greek society, and has the privilege and rich has made a lot of compromise for the poor and a lot of social welfare system that really was established in the cities. The second period is after Vietnam War. Again, this country is deeply divided in a very public situation. It is Brezhnev, under the leadership of Brezhnev, the Soviet Union, provide a kind of force that enables people like Ronald Reagan to make the necessary adjustment and reform and help. But ever since the 1990s, the United States has remained the same in terms of social, political, economic structures. Never make any adjustment, never make any reform. By contrast, China's continuously make reforms and openness. Not reform the political system, but governance institutions has been in a kind of readjustment. So therefore, I think that being tough on China may enable the United States to make a necessary adjustment in terms of social structure, economic structure, and so on and so forth, which could be very painful. But with a strong enemy as China, maybe you were able to do that. But having said that, what we're going to do, what's going to happen from now on? I think first and foremost, I do not believe Cold War or new Cold War, because that requires number one, policy making is driven by ideology. Because of number two, the world can be divided into two camps, black and white. Number three, our two economies are totally independent, not dependent on each other. And number three, you need both sides to form alliances, prepared for the final confrontations. But nowadays, first, at least from China's point of view, the policy making is driven by interests, not by ideology. Number two, it is almost impossible to form a kind of two camps, black and white, like during the Cold War, and the people are doing their own business. Because of that, we cannot really make an economy independent of each other, but very interdependent of each other. Last but not least, of course, the kind of military alliance against each other kind of situation almost not repeatable, at least from China's side. And so I will conclude with this. I think that right nowadays, because we China's been rising, we have a kind of relationship that US-China relationship is a far transcendent bilateral relations. And every issue between the United States and China will have a global implications, either currency or trade imbalance, and you name it. Whatever Americans and Chinese do against each other or for each other will change the world, will have a huge impact on the world we live. And the second, whatever huge fundamental challenges, either environment, energy security, and so on and so forth, cannot be handled or cannot be solved, even not managed, without a kind of communication, coordination, and cooperation between the United States. That's a fact. And also, that's the first point. The second point I want to argue that not the US-China relationship is increasingly defined by internal politics rather than whether we can see eye to eye against each other on international issues. Because this kind of interdependence between United States and China has greatly diversified the interests in both countries. For example, nowadays, if you ask me what is US-China policy, I cannot tell you what it is, because whatever policy the White House could adopt, if the Wall Street loves it, and maybe the manufacturing sector will take it, if the energy industry loves it, and then the environmental group will be pissed off. If the labor union against it, maybe the trade people will love it. So it's a constant internal compromise and the bargain making. And the same thing in China. China's interests also greatly diversified. Any policy Beijing makes, if the Shanghai people say great, and people in Sichuan might be pissed off. So it's also constant internal compromise and bargaining process. So the, like it or not, ironically, the stability of the bilateral relationship between the United States and China, it depends rather on the capability of the top leaders to control the internal politics. And if this capability is stronger, we can see a more stable relationship. Doesn't matter if China and the United States see each other as enemy or friends. That's why in the past years, China usually can take the initiatives in stabilize a bilateral relationship, because like it or not, I'm not making a judgment. I just make a statement of fact. Like it or not, the Chinese leaders are more capable of controlling the internal dynamics than the United States. So as a result, I would say that the future of the bilateral relationship depends on two factors. Now I'll answer the question. Number one, to what extent China can continue this great policy of reform and openness. As long as China can continue to reform itself, not to please the United States, but for its own goodness, openness, reform, multilateralism, peace strategy, and I think it's positive for bilateral relationship, first. And second, to what extent this kind of chaotic situation in the United States can be tolerated. From my point of view, the Trumpism or whatever is unsustainable. United States as a great country simply cannot, you know, support this type of style or leadership in the long run. Also for, not for China, but for United States. So that's two factors. Having said that, I'm conditionally optimistic of the bilateral relationship simply because United States and China, no matter what you do, no matter how you say, cannot do without each other. That's a fact.
You know, we'll come back next year to see if what you said is true or not. But we're going to move from macro issues to the smaller issue, the hot button issue. So our third speaker is Murray Lieber from SIF. We'll talk about ASEAN